The dollar as a reserve currency gives one the ability to print the world's money. Being able to create debt gives you the buying power. Being able to print the world's currency, such as when we were in the COVID crisis, and being able to print the currency that around the world will be accepted, allowed us to sell more debt, that we could sell more debt, because when you buy debt, it's somebody else's currency. In other words, when one owns debt, the seller of that, the buyer of that debt, is owning your promise to deliver them currency. And when you have the world's reserve currency, it allows you to get into more debt. Now, getting into more debt has historically, if not done correctly or not done sustainably, in a way, it creates obligations to pay back. And those obligations to deliver currency and pay back have produced different types of problems in the future. And so debt is very short-term stimulative, and it's longer-term depressing, and the ability to do that and have others take on our liability. As John Conley said when he was the Treasury Secretary, the dollar was devaluing and a risk, he said, the dollar is our currency, but it's your problem. And that has a net benefit. It's a net benefit, but it, like most things, it's cyclical because you have to pay back, and it produces problems sometimes when you pay back. So the United States is more indebted as a result of it being a reserve currency, and it all depends on, you know, who's going to get stuck with that. I think that there is. There's goods and services that exist in a certain quantity, and then there's a certain amount of money and credit, and they interact. And that throughout history, if you have, let's say, an oil shock that is not accommodated by an easing of central bank policy, in other words, the production of more money and credit, then if there was, when I'm saying if there was the same money and credit and you had an oil shock, then as oil goes up, something else would have to go down, and it would produce one set of circumstances. It wouldn't produce the same inflation. It would produce a consequence, and it would produce a transfer of wealth from those who are selling the oil at a high price. They gain wealth, and it would produce a decrease in the wealth from those who are having to pay that higher price. So, for example, it would make Middle Eastern countries richer, and it would make American companies and American entities poorer. And that's what would happen in a world in which we were to look at those items, and that certainly can cause a downturn in the economy. I learned early on that many things that happened to me and came as a surprise were things that didn't happen in my lifetime, but happened many times before. The first of those, 1971, I was clerking on the floor of the New York Stock Exchange when on August 15th, President Nixon got on and said, we are not going to pay the gold. I went on the floor of the stock exchange. That never happened to me before. I thought it would be a crisis and everything would go down. And I was totally wrong, and I found out that the stock market that morning went up more than it had in decades. And that led me to research and find out that on March 5th, 1933, President Roosevelt did the exact same thing, and it led to the exact same result. And I learned at that mistake, I learned that things that happened in my lifetime, but happened before and I didn't experience, were good rules. And so I needed to study, for example, the dynamic of the Great Depression. And by studying that dynamic of the Great Depression, I and we at Bridgewater were able to anticipate the 2008 financial crisis and do very well in it, only because we looked at those things that happened, before. And so it's that which led me to do this study. I did this study not to write a book. I did the study because these things that are happening now did not happen in my lifetime. So I wanted to study the cycles, and like the rise and decline of reserve currencies, empires, and so on. So I needed to study the last 500 years. And so what is conveyed in this book is what I learned from doing those studies, those patterns. And I put it out there for people to judge for themselves the merit of them. They can judge for themselves. I understand different people might have different views, and it's totally their prerogative. It's out there for people to learn, and it's been that approach and the systemization of that approach with a lot of great people that has been the basis of our success. I have this belief that what brings me satisfaction is excellent work and excellent relationships. And I believe that I was taught it really in the markets through my experience that being as accurate as possible is my goal, and that to get at truth, what is true, is fundamentally important in both making better decisions and also making good relationships, trustful relationships. And so for that reason, it seemed apparent that whether it's in the markets or it's with dealing with people, that being radically truthful and trying to work things through to find out what the best thing to do given those realities are is fundamentally beneficial. So I think I was all through my life, maybe to some extent, I was influenced to do that. It just seems like such the obviously better thing to do than to be the other. I think it's very odd that the world questions being very radically truthful and radically transparent with each other to try to find out what's true. I think that's a problem that the world faces in terms of those sort of things. But anyway, I came by it that way, and I wouldn't compromise it. And as the company grew, so as I say, we grew from a couple of people in my at a two-bedroom apartment. It came out of the other part of the other bedroom, and then it grew. And it was, as we grew to, let's say 1,500 people, there needed to be an organization and a culture that is built around those things. And so that became of paramount importance. And so we built our culture, and it's not for some people, and it's great for other people. And so with time, we've done that, and that's what we do.